Namaskar viewers, it's a matter of great pride, privilege and pleasure to have in our portals Dr. Sruti Mohapatra, the founder of Swabhiman. She has been fighting for the rights and dignity of the differently abled for the last 27 years. Welcome, ma'am, to RSTV.
Thank you
so
much.
Let me give the viewers a small, tiny glimpse of the personality and achievements of Dr. Sruti. A topper and gold medalist in both graduation and post-graduation, a national debating champion, a basketball player par excellence, a literary champ, Dr. Sruti's achievements have been truly awesome. After she had qualified for the civil services examination in 1987, a tragedy struck. She met with a road accident which left her paralyzed from neck below. Since then, she has been fighting a battle that has taken her and many others like her to new horizons, new vistas. Most people would have wallowed in self-pity and cursed fate, but Dr. Sruti Mohapatra is made of a different metal. Showing incomparable toughness, she bounced back, scripting a tale of resilience and inspiration. She is today the beacon light for the children of a lesser God and an icon for everybody else.
Thank you.
Ma'am, to begin this interaction,
yes,
could you share with our viewers your mental and emotional state after the accident?
Well, immediately after the accident, I had to practically give the information about the accident to people, because apart from me, everybody else in that accident, seven other women in all age groups were either badly injured or could not communicate. And when I arrived in the hospital, I knew something was wrong with me, but I kept pushing the doctors and telling them to look at the others who were hugely bleeding or with broken ribs, shattered, fragmented, and I was the only one who had not a drop of blood oozing out. My only question to the doctors in the hospital throughout my hospitalization had been, when will I walk? What is my condition? Will I recover? But it is unfortunate that doctors are in Orissa continuously kept on telling me that I will recover, it's but a matter of time.
Uh-huh.
But so my hopes were raised,
right.
But when I arrived in Vellore in Christian Medical College Hospital,
right,
the first interaction, doctors told me, you will never be able to walk.
My God.
And I was shattered.
Naturally.
Shattered and broken, but a wonderful family behind me, my father, mother, my younger sisters and my brother and close relatives. They stood behind me like a rock. My father never discussed disability with me. He said, okay, you're on a wheelchair, what after this? So that is the kind of support and inspiration that I got from my family.
That's really wonderful.
And blessings of all my elders that I could, and the doctors in Vellore, who gave me hope. So I started planning for a new life on the wheelchair. But a rude shock awaited me in my arrival in Bhubaneswar. And in Bhubaneswar in the 80s was a place where people, indulged in everything that was not their business, commenting on everything.
Right.
So everyone who met me was either crying or was patting me and feeling sad for a bad future ahead for me. But some went to the extent of being very rude on my face without really meaning to be
anything,
rude.
Huh? They did everything which should not have been done.
Yes,
almost, yeah.
And that is when my father was in Chennai then undergoing a kidney transplant with my mother. And so I was in a very, very bad state for some period of time till my parents came back.
Ma'am, it's very surprising that I do not know why it's the society, which behaves like this. I was talking to Arunuma Sinha, the lady who was, thrown on the tracks and, she suffered amputation in one leg and the other leg she had some splinters and all. So she said what hurt her the most was pity.
Yes.
And unintentionally, people indulge in this kind of sympathy and pity and they don't realize what kind of damage they are doing to the individual.
Yes. Yes. I must tell you, Ramendra, I have spent 95% of my time convincing others that I have the capability, although I knew I have the capability, number one. Number two, people are unnecessarily over-sympathetic and always pitying. Number three, they are always in right in front of your face without really meaning anything bad. They keep on telling, oh, she cannot walk, oh, she cannot marry, because I was then, my wedding was just a week ahead when my accident happened. Oh, what will it, oh, the boy will, what will, some even went to the extent of telling, oh, how sad she met that boy, had they met few days later, then they would not have been also going through a mental turmoil. So sometimes I believe in our society, we unintentionally become very cruel, to people who are going through very difficult challenges in their life. Here I find the Western countries are different because they prepare you for various possibilities in life, and people treat you as a human being first. They look at your capabilities and not what you cannot do.
What you cannot do.
And that we need to change, that attitude. It's not just with person with disabilities.
No, it's for everybody.
It's for everybody. Yeah. We always look at what a person cannot do. Whereas we should be looking at, even if the person cannot do 9 things, if the person can do 1 thing, let us look at that, focus on that, and then that person will achieve wonders in life.
That's a beautiful thought, absolutely. So you're saying we should move from sympathy to empathy?
Yes, we need to. We need to move that. We need to move from looking from no's to yes, you know. Cannot do, cannot do, cannot. It's fine. Everybody cannot become an astronaut.
Yeah,
but that person can become a great artist. Yeah. If that person cannot do maths and science, that's okay. The person can do fine arts. That person can do music. That person can do fashion. That person can do sports. So this is an attitudinal change which is very, very urgently needed in India. Because if you look at the statistics we have of young people, you see, even in very top institutes like IIT, we have students committing suicide.
Yeah.
So one of the reasons is we always try to push a person towards that area where he or she doesn't have the capability. Whereas we should look at that one talent which that person has and push him or her in that direction, and he or she will excel. Look at Padma Shri Sudarshan Patnaik.
He is amazing.
Just
absolutely
look at that.
Awesome, awesome.
He was never good in studies.
Yeah, he was a 9-year-old who was, doing the job of a, a small manservant or
exactly.
Something like that.
And look at the limits where he's exploring, how far he's going. Now he's just entered the Guinness Book of World Records. So that attitude needs to change in India, at least, and so much so in Odisha. We have to start looking at potentials, not at what a person cannot do.
That's true.
Yes.
Can you just retrace back a little bit and tell us that what was it that kept you going amidst all these adverse circumstances, apart from the inspiration of your family?
Yes. What kept me going, there was a lot of anger in me. The anger of rejection, that humiliation. You know, you have been at the top of your career all your life, and you have been a much coveted student. You have been a good person. Your parents love you. Your teachers love you. Your friends love you. And you think, you start thinking that life is always good if you're a good person.
True.
And then suddenly, what changed after my accident? My physical mobility, which I compensated, the wheelchair compensates.
True.
But society rejected me completely. I could not join the Indian civil services.
Yeah.
Just think of an administrative officer, the chief secretary of Odisha, or the cabinet secretary of India. He or she doesn't need a pair of legs. What he requires is the brain.
Brain, true.
But I was rejected because I was in a wheelchair. Number two, my marriage broke down. Number three, people were heaping humiliations on me in all kinds of sides. So there was a lot of anger in me. But because of the inspiration I was getting at home, because my father said, let us look ahead, what is possible. And he gave me a mantra of yes, I can, for every little thing. You know, being able to hold a spoon and eating independently was a matter of celebration in my home.
Great, great.
The day I could sit on a wheelchair without falling unconscious was a day of celebration.
So these incremental celebrations continued.
Yes, this continued. So it kept me motivating that yes, I'll do it. Yes, and my doctors in Vellore always kept communication with me. They said, hope is your best friend and everything is possible on a wheelchair. So just don't give up. Even if the society is not cooperating with you, don't give up. So because of that, and because my father never looked at my disability and he said, what next? He said, forget it. If the civil, they do not want you to join the civil services, at some point of time, they will realize it's a big loss for them. It's not a loss for you. Let us plan what you can do. So I went back to the university, completed my MPhil and my PhD after my accident, where again I faced a lot of humiliation. It is the same university where I have been a gold medalist, a topper, a seminar secretary, a literary champion. And all my professors nod their head, no, she cannot do a PhD.
But why?
She is disabled, she is quadriplegic, she is on a wheelchair, look at her fingers, they are curled fingers, she cannot be. Only one professor believed in me, Dr. Priyambada Hesmati, and because of her belief, she said, okay, if you don't want, I'll take her unto me. So I do a PhD. Again, a lot of physical challenges, you know. Every time I would get down from the car, because there would be a boy assisting me, he would lift me up like a little baby from the car and put me on the wheelchair. By the time I'm settled on a wheelchair, there will be 100 people surrounding me and staring at me. Because I was undergoing the bladder and bowel training, I would often wet my clothes. So, but every time my family found out a solution to that, you know, I remember my mother cutting out old towels and making thick pads for me so that I would be comfortable in university. My professor creating a back gate in the university for me so that my car would go in without people staring at me. She assigned a research scholar who would assist me in my things like filling up my forms, getting books for me from the library, taking the photographs. So with so much of support, and here Ramendra, before I go on, I must tell you, even if nobody believes in you, you must believe in your dreams. Once you believe in yourself, there will be one or two persons who will come and believe in your dreams and you can take it forward. So I completed my PhD and I got a National Young Scientist Award, and that was a day of celebration both in the department and in the family, because it had nothing to do with my disability.
True.
Right?
That was a great moment.
Yes, but then was a bad phase for me. Every private college I went to and applied, because PSC had not been advertised for a lecturership. Every research institution I went to rejected me. I would be the best in the interview. I would know that of all the candidates there, I am the best as far as academic records are concerned. But when the results will be announced, if there would be two positions, I would be third. If there would be six positions, I would be seventh. And then I knew my wheelchair has grown so big that my wheelchair has completely overshadowed me.
It has dwarfed you completely.
People don't see me. People only look at my wheelchair. And then I told my father, it's time to commit a suicide because I don't exist anymore. And he said, okay, that's an interesting idea. We'll think about it. Now let's look at what are the other things that you can do. And you know how I started? I started tuitions at home. Class 6, 7 students, then came the 8th, then 9th, then 10th, and I was teaching them at home. Then I started a small hobby house where I was teaching children and women also, housewives, spoken English and communication skills. And then you see how one grows. And then I said, why not the civil services? Because we didn't have a coaching institute then. And then I started my training institute. I had only 6 students in the first day, but all 6 of them are highly placed in life now.
Great.
So that's how slowly, that's what kept me going. How to channelize this anger in a more creative way. There was a lot of anger, there was a lot of humiliation. I was always thinking, I am that same person, that same heart, that same brain. But just because of a wheelchair, society is rejecting me. And I used to feel very sad. I'll show everybody one day. I will show them that it's possible to achieve great heights on a wheelchair. And the wheelchair has nothing to do with Sruti Mohapatra. This distinction I have to show to the society.
Great.
And my father would always say, practice, yes I can, yes I can. And with yes I can, I am here talking to you.
Wonderful, really wonderful to listen to this inspirational journey. Ma'am, one more thing, how did Swabhiman happen?
96, I got involved with an Prior to 96, I got involved in a lot of voluntary activities in disability in my home state in Bhubaneswar, and then with Red Cross and other organizations. And then in 1996, I got involved with DPI, Disabled People's International. Uh-huh. They started their chapter in India.
Mm-hmm.
So there was a meeting in Siliguri. Somebody was supposed to go. Mm-hmm. The gentleman suddenly called me from Odisha. He was supposed to go. He said, there is a meeting in Siliguri. I cannot go. Would you like to go and explore what it is? I said, why not? I was reticent. My mother said, why not? Let's go. Let's see what's happening. And then I reached there accidentally. And then I became part of the movement. And then I was traveling all across the world, observing, learning, absorbing. And every time I came back to India and Odisha, I was a very sad person. Nothing was happening here. Persons with disabilities were second-class citizens. No, persons with disabilities were not citizens. They just existed awaiting death. And then I said, what is it that we should do? What do people need? So, you know, by then Dad was not there. Dad had left this earth, planet Earth. So I started, the way he had trained me, I started writing down. He would always say, write down your yeses and nos and see which is exceeding. So I started writing down, what do persons with disabilities, do they want a pension? Do they want money? Do they want wheelchairs? So one thing which again and again struck me is information. What people need is information. Any person who has information has that ability within himself or herself to go anywhere, do anything. Number two, they need a little bit of support in terms of somebody advocating for their rights, because everybody is not communicative. And they need a place from where they can get all this information. So keeping all these things in mind, and in those times, there were just lot of NGOs, but there was an NGO for the blind, there was an NGO for the deaf, there was an NGO for the mentally challenged. But there was no organization which was looking at the larger or the cross disability issues like education, access, employment. So keeping all these things in mind, we started Swabhiman, State Disability Information and Resource Center. And Swabhiman looks at, initially we started with providing information. That was our main forte, and advocating with the government at policy level for change in policies so that persons with disabilities become equal partners. That's how we started Swabhiman.
I have gone to a couple of countries abroad. They are so disability friendly. And here it is so pathetic. I mean, it fuels anger in you. But why is it, even at a policy level or the government level, there is so much of unconcern?
I'll tell you. You see, across the world, everyone had that attitude of what you call charity towards persons with disabilities. Because if you go back in history, you'll find most of them, they were killed, whether West or the East.
Because they were
a
burden.
They were killed. They were not just a burden, they were abnormal.
Uh-huh.
You know, they were Saturn.
Uh-huh.
Then they were created out of sins committed in past life by themselves or their family members.
Uh-huh.
And so hide them or kill them or forget them. But it was the First World War which actually awakened the entire world, because when war veterans started returning back with injuries and disabilities, then the entire world woke up. Right. Oh, what are we doing? They are our friends, you know, colleagues and family members. That's when the concept of rehabilitation started. All the rehabilitation institutes, doctors, therapists, they taking over the lives of persons with disability. Then it moved from killing to charity to rehabilitation. Then started, a survey was done by WHO in the 80s, where they said 10% of the population is disabled. That's when the country like US, which took the first step. You said, if 10% of my population is disabled and they're just in some kind of a rehab center, they are burdens. So let us convert them into people who can contribute, productive people. And that's how disability became a discourse in development and in economy. But unfortunately, India, even only for the last few years, the attitude has been that of charity, you know. Like take oranges and distribute, take blankets and distribute, wheelchairs, distribute hearing aids.
And photo ops and everything else.
That attitude changed, that paradigm shift came in 2009 when UN did a convention, the UNCRPD, and they said the entire a person with disability is another human being first. Disability comes much later. So any right that any human being has, a person with disability must have. So that rights based approach or a complete shift in attitude towards disability happened in 2009. Happened in other countries earlier, but globally the UN accepted 2009, and then it said that all the member countries have to modify its law. So in India our law started in 2010, but only last year in December we got our first rights based law, which says Rights of Persons with Disabilities Act. So now, of course, from now onwards, anything that is done, any policy decision that is to be done, has to be done keeping rights of persons with disability in its perspective. Till now it was charity, but US and the other countries, they thought about it much earlier. So there you find the American Disability Act celebrated 25 years only 5 years back. So so once there is a strong law, there is a will to implement, and there is a budget for it, a lot of things can happen.
True, absolutely.
So in India we have before this we had 4 laws. We have good laws, we have good policies.
But implementation is not
there. What about budget? Without budget.
What can they do?
Yeah. See, even now if you look at budget of India, disability doesn't come out. If you do an analysis, you will find that even the main department doesn't have a, except the persons with the disability department. No other department has a budgetary head on disability. It's not visible. So the more important thing right now is budget. And I think with Prime Minister looking at it and Niti Aayog also looking at it, I'm sure that in India, of course, this year was very sad. 2017 budget is not expected. It's much low because now the categories of disability have been extended from 77 to 21 now. The new law, I'll tell you about the new law, two things. Earlier we had only 7 disabilities certified by Government of India who will get facilities. This has been extended to 21. Now you even have Parkinson's, you have acid attack survivors as disabled. And the definition says disability is a dynamic concept. So later on, suppose the kidney or the heart people come together, then you get another disability.
That's nice.
So that's a good thing which has happened. We hope there will be more money, then the plans can work.
I know. A couple of years back, I had gone to attend the Anjali festival.
Yes.
And I think it was an awesome experience.
Yes.
Seeing the children and seeing the way you manage the whole thing and all. And seeing their love for you and your love for them. So, how did you start this Anjali? What was the idea behind it?
Of all the projects that I run in Swabhima, and my most passionate project is Anjali. I just love it. The concept came when I was traveling in the US and I visited a lot of schools and activities. I saw children with disabilities are at par with their classmates. They're doing into a lot of activities. Coming back in Odisha or India also, I saw children either in the special schools, they are involved in some activity, or they're in the hospitals. Even at home, you don't find them involved. You don't see their talents being portrayed before society. A few NGOs do, it's not that nobody is doing anything, but it's not really significant. Number two, it always struck me, why should our children be reading in special schools? We should all study together.
Yeah.
We should all grow up together. We should understand each other. So in Anjali, number one, my focus was joyful learning. Number two, inclusive education. So in Anjali, the program that we do, we have workshops. In each workshop, we have children with disability and those without.
Yeah.
You know, you must have seen.
Yeah, yeah.
So in these 5 days, they explore each other, they learn each other, they understand each other. And from the theatre workshops, we have had some of the most amazing friendships which have cropped, you know.
That is really incredible.
Yeah. Those who cannot speak and hear, and those who are in schools like Mothers and Ruchika, we have wonderful friendships going ahead. So this is number one, you know, because if you talk about inclusion, spending lakhs of rupees and doing workshop doesn't achieve much. But if you target children and if you target youth, then they understand. So in Anjali, number one, we have this wonderful inclusion. Number two, we sensitize the college students. They are the volunteers who carry out all the work, from receiving the teams and the resource persons to even cleaning the grounds, conducting the activities. So here we have about 100-120 youth every year from local colleges experiencing disability at very close quarters, interacting with children with disability at very close quarters. And I think that gives rise to empathy. And the two, three examples that I can share with you is one of my volunteers, Padma Mohanty, when she joined the Indian Forest Service and got posting in Periyar, the first thing she did was in Periyar, she got a jetty made accessible.
Oh.
Yes. And similarly, another volunteer who went to London, studied and then joined a international NGO, Bernard Van Leer. They started a project here in Odisha called Hamara Bachman. So the first thing that she suggested is, why are we not, we were working in the slum with all these children, but where are the children with disabilities? They have to be part of this.
Yeah.
So that level of sensitivity I have been able to impart, and though in a very small number, but I'm very proud of the things that we are doing in Anjali. Actually, we are reaching out. We have now students. Yes, I must tell you, we have now students, the engineering students, who are taking up projects in their college courses, which deal with assistive devices on persons with disabilities.
That's fantastic.
So this is inclusion that we are looking at, you know.
And this will create a permanent impact. I mean,
yes.
It's not a cursory kind of thing.
Yes. And then all the contests that we have in Anjali, they are all inclusive. The disabled and the non-disabled, the contest together on the same dais, irrespective of whether they can do good or bad. You know, some lose, some win, but it creates a spirit of, you know, that fear. Any time later in their life, they will not be afraid of performing in front of persons who don't have disabilities.
Nice.
So that is, we are creating a small little beautiful world where those disabled, those non-disabled understand and accept each other. So accept differences and celebrate diversity.
Yeah.
That's something that you
perfect.
Are doing.
Perfect, absolutely,
mentally.
Perfect.
Yes.
You are also associated with the OSDN.
Yes.
Could you share about something about it?
You see, at the end of the day, NGO is a small organization with a small reach. But when you come together, you become a mighty force.
True.
So for Swabhiman, it was not possible to do all the campaigns on its own. So I just thought about it, what to do, and we created a partnership with like-minded NGOs and individuals across Odisha, and we call it Odisha State Disability Network, and we take up campaigns together. We have our own activities, but like the census 2011, where we came together, shared information, both 1 and 11, and you'll be happy to know that because of this networking and because of our extensive campaigning, although the census of data of India says the percentage of population is 2.19, whereas in Orissa, the percentage is 2.9. Actually, it should go up to 10, but 2.9 is remarkable because we really worked together, and in 30 districts, we were vibrant, we were working. We were talking to enumerators, talking to the master trainers, talking to the NGOs. And just creating that, you know, that vibrant thing in India, which didn't happen anywhere else. Other was establishing the office of the Disability Commissioner, which should have happened in 1995. But this was not happening. Lot of lobbying was going on. In 2010, through our network partners, we got together. There were about 1,000 people in Bhubaneswar. We had a meeting. We all went, met the Chief Minister, the opposition leaders, the all the heads of the different political parties, and you see, we got a commissioner that same year. Number other successful has been the political interface we had before the general elections, and we could sensitize some of the political parties to include disability in their manifesto. So these are some very vibrant campaigns which could happen because of this networking.
Great.
Yes.
Ma'am, this what would be your advice to the differently abled?
Yes. I have lot of advices. I have separate set of advices for the parents and separate for the
that's
youth.
Important.
You know, the youth, I want to talk to them. Number one, don't press forward for this pensions and doles and aids. That's 300 rupees pension. You will fight for it, lobby for it, give me 500 per month. How does it add to the quality of your life?
Exactly.
Rather than, if you lobby with, go and lobby with Alimco. Tell them, I don't want this badly manufactured wheelchair which is breaking down in 6 months. Pre- prepare good wheelchair for us. Don't give us these outdated tape recorders. Give us laptops. If you want to lobby with the government, lobby in these lines. This thing. Number two, I would tell all of them to get educated. Ramendra, if I'm here talking to you and people say that I have been able to do something in my life, is because of education. My father always said, educate, educate, educate. If you educate a person, he or she will learn to earn their livelihood. So I want all of them to be educated. Number three, I don't want them to be jumping from one skill development program to other till they are 35, 40 years of age. I feel very saddened that many of them are spending their life jumping from one program to another.
Why do they do that? Lack of confidence?
They just don't do anything in life except take training, because there is always a component of stipend attached to that.
Uh-huh.
So you have to break it. First, you have to live with dignity. When you start earning and you become an asset to your family will feel proud of you. If your family is proud of you, your community will respect you. If your community is respect you, the sky is the limit for you. So you have to lead a life of dignity and then start your charity work. I would also advise them not to get into this NGO formation business. Everyone is floating an NGO.
True.
Join hands with the good NGOs in your local area and bring about changes. And if you are not getting a government job, forget it. Don't cry for a government job. Go ahead, become an entrepreneur, start a small cycle repair shop, then employ two other persons. Do something and become a job creator. Don't run after this thing. And to the parents, I'll tell them, don't be overprotective or don't be over idolize your child. My child is this good, dancing, you know, scored. No. Your child has to be at the end of the day employable. Focus on that. And don't be overprotective. Don't hide them. Don't feel embarrassed about them. Believe in them. Believe in your children. Support them in the process so that they are able to convert their dreams into action, and be proud parents after that.
Great. Wonderful. Finally, I would rather two questions.
Yes.
One is, your today is International Women's Day.
Yes.
And you've been invited by Rourkela Steel Plant.
Yes.
And we are very happy that you could come here.
Thank you.
What would be your advice to the women?
I would advise them to just follow the theme of this year. Be bold to become a change. To bring about a change in the society, we all have to become change makers. And I strongly believe that each one of us, men or women, are unique. We have a lot of potential inside us, but we have to learn to respect ourselves, believe in ourselves, have big dreams, and work hard, work consistently to realize that dream. Then, Ramendra, sky is the limit for anyone, men, women, or everyone.
Right. I read somewhere your quote, you know, it's so beautiful. To be happy, give joy to others.
Yes. I have learnt a couple of things in ashram from Guruji and Swamiji's. Guruji always says this other quote also, which I believe in, give back. We are only taking. It's time to start giving back. Giving back is not always money. Give back your time, your skill, and your sweet little words to bring. And to be happy, give joy to others, give happiness to others. That is the only truth in this world. If you want to eat, have five people with you, share your food and enjoy. If you want to do anything in life, ultimate happiness will come when people around you are happy. When you radiate an aura of happiness that not just human beings, plants, animals, and the environment around you resonates with happiness. And being happy does not mean just I will acquire. I will have 5 cars. I will have 10 buildings. I will have a big bank balance. My children will be the topper. That's not the way to happiness. I believe in the Hindu philosophy which says, Sarve bhavantu shukhina sarve santu niramaya. Sarve bhadrani pashyantu ma kaschit dukha bhagavati. In everybody's happiness, why should everybody be happiness? Because in everybody's happiness is my happiness.
My happiness.
In everybody's growth is my growth. In everybody's prosperity is my prosperity. We should always think of everybody growing and developing, not just me and me.
That was really wonderful. And this interesting chat, this inspiring, this motivating little conversation we've had, I think will be etched in my mind as well as in your mind, my dear viewers. A few pointers which she has said: give back to the society, spread joy, spread happiness, inclusive holistic growth. And above all, in giving happiness to others lies our own happiness. These are pointers which are so important in today's society, which is moving towards a self-centered and egocentric kind of growth. Thank you, ma'am, for this wonderful, wonderful interview.
Thank you
and all the best to you for all your endeavors.
Thanks. Thank you so much. Namaskar.